Hey guys, a lot of you have asked what our experience has been 4 months into getting our solar panels installed and how the efficiency of the panels has compared to the estimates from the installer. So let's take a look. All right guys, welcome back to Saving Green, your stop for sustainability on a budget. So today we're going to look at the proposal from the solar installer and see how those numbers have compared 4 months into our solar installation system. Let's dive right in. We have a 16 kilowatt system installed, and you can see the proposal here. Basically, the breakdown by the proposal is the total cost, the total savings over the course of 30 years of standard utilities, assuming a 3 or 4% inflation adjustment every year, the estimated total annual production in kilowatt hours, this is AC current, the interest rate of the loan, and the duration of the loan, which in our case was 20 years plus a year and a half of interest-only payments. So it also breaks down some, you know, feel-good numbers, how many trees were saved, vehicles off the road, barrels of oil not consumed. So that's an overview of how the layout was initially designed for the house. We see that we have southern exposure at the bottom, we have western exposure and eastern exposure panels that maximize overall usage. And kind of breaks down what the monthly bill would be after we factor in the federal rebates of 26%. And here we can see basically month to month what the average production is. And we see that it basically breaks down to about 2,000 kilowatt hours every month. Now, when we had the system prepared for us, there were a few inefficiencies that we addressed. One is our old AC units. One is our water heater. And the other is basic insulation with, you know, certain windows and things of that nature. So we priced our system at about 2,000 kilowatt hours, which is a 33% reduction, which was fairly realistic based on the utility changes that we made. That breaks down to about 66 kilowatt hours every day of production or consumption, depending on how you look at it. This is a breakdown of what the yearly savings would be. Again, this is a 4.5 inflation rate, which is a little exaggerated. And this is a breakdown of the solar components that we had installed. Microinverters, I think, are better, even though they're a little bit more expensive than a standard collective series inverter. And they also include some AC units, 2 3-ton units and things like that. So our house is about 3,000 square feet. So that's a rough breakdown of our proposal. So let's see how it compares. So the Enphase inverters basically have a system that's coded into this MyEnlighten framework. And we can go day by day and look at each array. We can zoom in the south array, the west, and the east. Now you might notice that one of these panels actually has a little bit weakened production. We live on a golf course. So unfortunately, golf balls can damage a panel, and boom, outside, I'll show you pictures. It's not looking good. Here you can see our panel's broken. It kind of sucks. In fact, we also have some damage to our eastern facing array. We've got two panels right here, one on this particular day at 109 kilowatt hours versus 1.17 kilowatt hours versus all the adjacent panels of about 1.3. Okay? Now, what's nice about the microinverters is you can look at each panel individually and look at the comparative productivity. So west and east, actually pretty comparable. We would expect our western panel to be a little bit better overall than east because we're in the western hemisphere as well. But because of the environmental dynamics in South Florida with afternoon thunderstorms, our eastern panels actually are pretty comparable. And we would expect south to be a little bit higher. Again, in this particular day, really no variability. But if we look compared to Thursday the 18th, again, our eastern had to be most production. This means we had afternoon thunderstorms. If we go Wednesday, we see that our southern exposure was actually fairly productive, about 1.7 average. Again, our east was going full blown at high gear, 2.10. So we can actually look over each day, and it also gives us a nice breakdown hour by hour as to the net consumption versus production. So in this particular day, we produced 69 kilowatt hours overall from our panel. And we consumed 105 total kilowatts according to this system. And we ultimately had a net import of 36 kilowatt hours, okay? So if we have a net input of 36 kilowatt hours at about, you know, 12 cents a kilowatt, we're looking at, you know, a few dollars worth for this particular day. We also can go down into the production And this is broken down basically day by day. The lighter the color on this grid, the more the overall production. And you can see kind of a breakdown by each day, how it averages out. And we can even look at overall lifetime values, 9.65 megawatts produced. We can also break it down into months. So again, our proposal was for 2,000 kilowatt hours on average. So we see here, June, looking good. May, looking good. April, looking good. March, looking really good. February, not so good, because that's when we got it actually finalized and up and running. So we had basically half a month's worth of productivity in February. So our estimates were right on target in terms of our overall productivity goals. What about consumption? Well, our consumption is still pretty high according to this grid. And it seems like we might be producing a little bit less than what we're consuming. So our target production of about 24,000 kilowatt hours every year seems to be looking appropriate, but our consumption doesn't seem to be offset according to this. Is that really the case? Well, there is some disconnect between what the microinverters are processing and how it's interpreting that energy usage versus what FP&L is actually delivering each day. And that's where our utility bill comes in. So when you log on to FP&L, you've got this billing summary here. And here it says that our utility bill estimates for June is $38.67. Okay, not bad, not 100% offset, but certainly not the 3,000 kilowatt hours that are consumed. Because if we think about 3,000 hours of consumption versus 2,000 of production, our bill should be somewhere over $100. So we're seeing that that's actually not the case. So why is that? Well, let's keep looking a little bit deeper into the numbers. So here we have kind of our new charges. We have a nice breakdown of what these summary charges are. It's broken down into non-fuel and fuel charges. You know, that's kind of where our numbers average out to about 10 to 12 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, we have for electricity usage about $29 worth of charges for this month. We've got about $6 worth of credits. And we have this Surge Shield program, which is, again, an extra surcharge just to make sure that if we get struck by lightning, our panels won't blow up. So I think it's worth it. Total for this month, $38. Now for the good stuff. Now if we compare this energy usage compared to where we were last year, look at that, $437.70. Are you freaking kidding me? Now we're looking at $38. That's amazing. That is incredible. Not only were our 18-year-old AC units just costing us a boatload of money, but by making the adjustments with solar, now we're looking at a $28 a month net. Now look at last month, even less, boom, $10. That's only the surge protection, meaning all of our other chargers were washed away and we got a credit. We went from $437 last June to $28 this June. Looks pretty good. Let's dig a little deeper. Now FP&L also gives us our energy usage tab. Again, a comparison breakdown. It looks at our total kilowatt hours, 251 hours net consumed this month, more than last month, $18 net increase based on that charge. This month had two more days in it, and then the average temperature, no difference in the average temperature. Trust me, it was not 0 degrees in South Florida. The average temperature was 85 degrees, but the net change was zero. So the comparison month to month, we kind of see how this has worked out. February, we had the units installed, so we didn't get the full benefit of solar, we got half. March, no charge, $10 only, $9.90 only for the surge protection. April, $9.90 only for surge protection, complete offset. May, complete offset. June, starting to catch up to us. The heat's kicking in, and now we owe a little bit of money, but not too bad. Now we're gonna go into the energy dashboard. And this is a really exciting screen because this gives us a breakdown of all last year's utility payments and how they compare after solar was installed again in February. So the total energy delivered is basically the equivalent of consumption. In February, when the unit was installed, we were charged $115.72. They delivered 1309 kilowatt hours and they received 207. So not a whole lot. Now this created a net of 1309 minus 207 is net consumption. Now they charged us 115, so let's just figure out what the price per kilowatt hour was. Divided by 115, was about just under 10 cents per kilowatt hour, okay? So that was the total cost in February once the units were installed. Now, in March, we used a little bit less, okay? So in March, we only used 946 kilowatt hours, but they received 1146. So we contributed an extra 200 kilowatt hours to the grid. Now, what was our payment? Still 990, because that's the sole cost of the surge protection. We had no net additional fees for this month. So our only out-pocket cost for March was surge protection and the loan amount, which happened to be all interest, of about 150 bucks. So 159 bucks in March. Now, if we compare that to last year, it's crazy how expensive it was. So in March, we gained 200 kilowatt hours in our reserve. In April, we used 1,081 and we sent 1,187 back to the grid. So we contributed an additional 106 kilowatt hours, added that to the 200 previously. We have 306 in our bank, okay? So in May, it's about a wash. I'm not sure why we lost our reserve. So now in June, let's think about what the bill should be based on only these numbers. So 1356 minus 800 is 556, okay? Now, if we average this at about 10 or 11 cents per kilowatt, should be paying $61, okay? Now, we're not paying $61. Why is that? Well, that's because we actually had a reserve of about 300. So if we have 556 and we subtract our reserve of about 300, now if we multiply by 0.11, we get 28. And that's the value we have here, $28. So they finally credited us our 300 extra production, and now we only owe $28. How do we compare that to June of last year? 35.35. So far, according to what FPNL is reading from our grid, not only are we producing pretty much a wash to what we're consuming, we are consuming a third of the energy of what we used to based on getting new air conditioning units and our efficiency improvements around the house. So we're looking at a significant savings from $437 last June to this, $28. So here we see that they're projecting what our bill will be. So July will probably be more expensive than June. Again, we have no more inner reserves. We're gonna go from basically $28 to potentially $41. And we kind of see how many kilowatts on average we're using per day. And it's saying that we're looking at about 13 kilowatt hours per day. So this is also kind of neat. We can look at our energy usage based on appliances. So air conditioning this time of year is far and away our maximal consumption source. And we see that water heater, it uses about 7%. And are always on, so all of our electronic devices, computers and charging devices, is about 14%. So it's not insignificant at all. So as you can see, so far, solar has really been delivering exactly what the expectations are. However, there actually is quite a bit of discrepancy between how FPNL is processing our solar production and what the end phase inverters are reporting the production to be. I'm not sure which is more accurate, but I would expect that the energy analyzer, according to the end phase, which is estimating at about 60 to 80 kilowatt hours produced every day, is probably fairly accurate because that's very close to what the projections were with the initial layout of the design. Now, granted, there are a few variables. One is one of the panels is damaged. The other is that my wife has been working from home. So our smart thermostats, like our Nest, is not kicking into away mode for most of the day. So our average temperature, instead of being set at 78 or 79 degrees when we're away, we still have animals, so we don't want to keep it too hot. But instead of it being set to 79, it's actually set to 75 or 76. So it's not a huge difference, but it is notable. And basically, it's still a work in progress. I'll be doing updates every few months just to kind of see how these numbers progress through the seasons. But this is our high demand time of year. So in summer, we would expect that we're gonna be producing a little bit less than we're gonna be consuming because of how hard our air conditioning units are gonna be working this time of year. If the world hasn't ended in the fall, we'll be updating this to kind of see what our energy production is comparatively as the temperature cools. but I just want to show you kind of a quick snapshot into the first few months of our energy production and how exciting it is to see an energy bill go from over $400 to around 20 bucks. So far solar's been amazing, and it's saved us a whole lot of money. Now granted, we have to add our loan cost to this amount. And even with the 30% back on our loan, we're looking at a little over $200 just in the loan amount each month, but that's still at least a 30 or 40% reduction in our overall cost, including our energy use and our loan from what we were paying before. And so far, it certainly has been paying for itself. Again, for anyone interested in learning ways to be more sustainable and save money, please check out some other videos and consider subscribing. I really appreciate you checking out Saving Green, and we'll see you next time. Bye.